Hey guys, this is Pastor Aldridge Callins here.
And Tenori Callins.
And we're so glad y'all are here. Hey, welcome to Church Online.
Parents, don't forget to check out our awesome kids services at churchontherock.net.
So guys, look, we have a great message prepared for you today. Really, I'm so excited for it. So this is what we want you to do. We want you to get your house ready for some worship. What does that mean? That means move your coffee table, move your sofa. I don't know if you need to put on and take off slippers, but get ready to get funky for Jesus. All right, guys, we're going to have a great service.
You are good. Oh, you we come before you and we thank you for this season. As hard as it may be, we know that there are so many mysteries inside this season that you are waiting to reveal. Lord, we will wait. We will lean in because you love us and you care for us. And as we go into the message, Lord, I pray that you would open up our hearts to receive this, and that we would learn all that we can about our perfect Heavenly Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Well, hey there, church. Welcome back to Church Online. I really, really just want to say thank you so much for just being connected to us and staying close throughout the season. I can assure you that I miss you guys so much, like crazy, and I can't wait until we are gathering back together again in person. But I really, really love being able to connect to you through this resource. Really appreciate those of you that take time to get on the chat and just talk to each other and talk to us and our team. It really is just awesome to stay connected. Honestly, I feel like some of us have become more connected actually in this season, perhaps, than we were before. And it's just been great. It's been an awesome experience to learn how to connect to people in unique ways. But I just appreciate you being tuned in today and coming back to Church Online. I'm really excited to get into today's message. We're going to be in a third part of a series that we've been calling Mind Games. We've been talking about the reality that our enemy is trying to play tricks on our mind. And I want to get deeper into that today. But one of the things that I've been doing each week just for fun is I've been bringing riddles to you. I think you've been enjoying them. I know that I'm enjoying bringing them. I hope you're enjoying trying to solve them. I think today is the best riddle that I've brought to you so far. So if you're in the chat this morning, get ready to throw your answer in there if you think you can figure it out. Here it goes. Here we go. You see a boat filled with people, yet there isn't a single person on board. How is this possible? You see a boat full of people, yet there isn't a single person on board. How is this possible? How is it possible? All right, while you're thinking and dropping your answers or best guesses into the chat, I want to make a couple of announcements to you. And it's really two things. I really want to start by just saying how proud I am of our church family. And here's the reason why. We have been getting more and more questions from people, and I mentioned this last week, people saying, how can we help? How can we get involved? We want to support people in need in this season. And we talked last week about how you can give at churchontherock.net/giving. We have a line specific to COVID-19. We're calling it disaster relief. It's a line that really stays there all the time so that we can respond when need comes. And I just want to thank you for caring enough about people who are hurting right now, who may be suffering in some ways. And those of you that have the ability, you've been contributing to their need. I really can't thank you enough. There's a new question though that has been rising up, and I'm very proud of you for asking this question too. In fact, I think that your question is in line with where my mindset is actually starting to go. And the question that's being asked is, hey, how can we get involved, like join teams? And some of you have said, hey, I was halfway through what our church calls All Access, which is our way of getting people connected and getting people serving. There were some of you that said, hey, I was partway through that, and then we had to stop gathering in person. There are some of you that have been saying, hey, I really want to get involved. I want to join a team so that when we are gathering again, I can just help the cause. And I really love the question because, again, I think your mind is going where my mind is starting to go. And that is that there is a reality that we will not be quarantined forever. We will not be asked to distance forever. And I think there's a certain anticipation about gathering in person once again. I'm excited to announce to you that we are going to do a digital online All Access. That is going to start today. You can find all the resources and all the information of how you can get involved to be a part of that if you want to on our website at churchontherock.net. And I just want to invite you to do that. Our host at the end of the service is going to remind you of that and tell you more about that. But if you're just interested in getting on a team, getting involved, becoming a part of the church, that would be the way in which you can do that. Okay, moments ago, I asked you a question. It was a riddle. It's our mind game. It was this: you see a boat filled with people, yet there isn't a single person on board. How is this possible? I'm actually going to pause. There are four people on the backside of the cameras today in studio recording with me. I'm going to ask, does anybody in studio know the answer?
I totally looked it up.
One of our team members said that they totally looked it up. Anybody have a guess that didn't look it up? Go, Janelle. Oh, that's a really good guess, that the boat's name is filled with people, but nobody's on board. I actually like the guess. Here's the actual answer. That was really clever. I really, really like that. Here's the actual answer. I'm not even going to let Timothy answer it because he looked it up. He cheated. I hope that none of you cheated and then put your answer in the comment. All right, here's the answer. You see a boat filled with people, yet there isn't a single person on board. How is this possible? All the people on the boat are married. So there's not a single person on board. I love it. I loved it. I think it's the best riddle that we've done so far. Hey, thanks for putting up with my nonsense. It's just in line with the series we're in called Mind Games. All right, I want to get into today's message. Part number three of this Mind Game series that we've been talking about and communicating on. Here, I want to give you a flash review of where we've been so that you can be best prepared to lean in with me today. Some of you have been a part of this series from part one, two, to now three. Others of you are tuning in for the very first time. Welcome, by the way, to Church Online. I want to highly recommend to you, if you've missed any of the installments of this series, I'm going to highly recommend to you that you go back and get caught up. I honestly believe it will benefit you greatly to do so. But in part number one, we said this. And hey, it's in your head. That was the title of my message. In other words, there's a battle going on in your mind. The enemy is trying to play games with you, lie to you, speak things about you that simply are not true. And so what I want to do is I just want to make you aware that, hey, he's going to try to play games in your mind. Part number two, last week, we talked about how it's in our hearts, because what we've done as a church family is we've been joining together every day on our website, and we've been going into a devotion each day where we are reading a devotion, we are reading the scripture and the truth of what God's word says about us, and then we've been declaring those truths. We've been speaking those truths out. The Bible says that the abundance of our heart, our mouth speaks. So it is what's inside of us that begins to come out of us. And so we've talked about the reality that, hey, it's in your head. This mind game thing is happening in your head. We've been putting God's word deep in our hearts. Title of today's message is this: it's in your hands. It's in your hands. Because here's the idea today, church, is that what is inside of you will eventually become the external part of you. So when I get the inside right, the outside begins to display it. And I want to talk about this. Each week we've read this verse. It's Romans chapter 12, verse 2. It says this. It says, "Don't be conformed to the pattern of this world. Rather, be transformed by the renewal of your mind." And what we've been trying to do is change the way we think. Why? Because our thoughts drive our actions. If I can get the right thoughts, if I can get myself to believe about me what God says about me, if I can understand my identity in Christ and who I am in Him, then when the enemy is trying to lie to me in my head, something in my heart rises up and says, "This is not who I am." I begin to declare the truth of who I am, and then all of a sudden the character of my life begins to transform. It begins to change. It goes from my head to my heart to my hands. Today I want to help you take another step. Again, I love to be practical. I try to be the most practical preacher I possibly can be, because what I want to do is help people actually utilize the truth of God's word to impact their real everyday lives. And so what I want to do today is I want to take you to an amazing story in the Bible that's probably, at least you've heard of it, familiar to all of us. But it's going to especially be familiar to those of us who have been grown up or raised up in the church, or those who are familiar with the Bible. But in the Old Testament of the Bible, in the book of 1 Samuel, there's an unbelievable story. It is the story of David and Goliath. Again, most of us have probably heard this story, but I want to take you to this remarkable story, and there's some things I want to point out today that I think are going to help us when it comes to this being in our hands, like the character and conduct of my life, my thoughts driving my action into a positive direction, into a lifestyle and a characteristic that is in line with my Heavenly Father, that is in line with my identity in Christ Jesus. And I want to take you to this moment where David, he is not King David yet. He is not the warrior David yet. In fact, this would be his first time ever into battle. Ironically, though, he's not even a soldier. He's a shepherd boy. He is a young shepherd who was actually just going to check on his brothers who were soldiers. And he sees this Goliath, this giant, taunting the Lord's army. And somehow he finds himself on the battlefield in front of this giant as this young, small boy. And if you know how the story goes, David would become the victor. But I want to take you to that actual moment that David steps into the battlefield. And the Bible tells us that Goliath comes down and he's insulted at who they bring to him. They didn't send in front of the giant their greatest warrior or their most seasoned or experienced fighter. It was some kid that they decided, hey, go take a chance for us. And the Bible says that Goliath says these words. He says, "What am I, a dog, that you come at me with sticks?" David wasn't dressed like a warrior. He didn't have on armor. He wasn't holding a sword. The Bible says that he went to the battlefield with his sling and some smooth stones. The Bible tells us that he would carry with him a club. And Goliath is incredibly insulted. "Well, am I some dog? Are you trying to play fetch with me that you come at me with sticks?" And I want to bring you to the 45th verse of 1 Samuel chapter 17. I want to bring you to what David says. Listen to this. David replied to the Philistine, "You come to me with sword, spear, and javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord Almighty." I love his boldness. I love David's confidence. Here's what I want to say to us. We've been talking about this reality of mind games, that Satan is trying to do some things. He's trying to play tricks in our heads, get us to believe things that are not true about who Christ says that we are. And I think that there's a perhaps temptation that some of us may fall into. And I don't mean temptation like sinful. I just mean like trickery. It's more part of the mind game, that you may be trying to come against your enemy in your own strength and in your own power. And here's what I want to say to you, Christ follower. If you are a born again Christian, if you are walking with Christ Jesus, here's what I want you to hear me say. We do not come against our enemy in our own strength and our own ability, because we are not enough. We come to our adversary, we come to our enemy in the name of the Lord Almighty. Let me give you a couple of perhaps silly examples, but something that I think might help contextualize my idea to you this morning. I'm a parent. I have three children. When my kids were smaller, I might send one of my kids to get the other kids. For example, if I was to say to Janelle, who did a fantastic job leading us in worship this morning, so proud of her. She just turned 18, amazing young lady. If I was to send small Janelle and said, "Hey, go get Carter, who is my son, and tell him that it's time for dinner." If Janelle goes in there and she says, "Hey, Carter, it's time for dinner," there's a chance that Carter may or may not come. But if I was to say, "Janelle, you go tell Carter that Dad said it's time for dinner." So then Janelle goes into the room and she tells Carter, "Hey, Carter, Dad said it's time to eat." What's the difference? The difference is that Janelle doesn't come to her brother, who's more of a peer, more on her level. She doesn't come to him in her own authority. She comes to him in the authority of her dad. Dad said. In other words, if you don't obey, you're not gonna have to deal with me. You're gonna have to deal with him. I want to help you, especially if you're a young Christian or if you're in the fight of your life in this game in your mind. I want you to hear me say something, that when you declare who you are in Christ, when you speak those scriptures, make those declarations, when you speak to your enemy, you are not coming at him in your power, because you are not enough. You are coming to him in the name of the Lord Almighty. You are coming to him with a much higher authority that has a much stronger hand that gives you the victory. I think it is important that some of you understand this. It is not your strength. It is not your ability. It is his. You walk in the authority of your heavenly Father. One more quick example, perhaps. that could help you. It's silly, it's fictitious, but maybe it'll help get a context for victory moving in your mind. Let's just say that you bump into someone who is immensely wealthy. They have all the resources and the things that you could ever imagine. And they say to you, you have access to all that is mine. In fact, here's my debit card. You go get anything that you want to get. You have access to my private jet, to my helicopter, to any of my vehicles, any of my stuff. It is all yours. Go and have fun. You would probably buy and do a little bit differently than you would on your own budget, wouldn't you? Especially if you felt comfortable enough to accept their generosity, you would have a confidence to utilize what is available to you through someone else. So I might buy something that I otherwise perhaps wouldn't have bought. I may take a flight on that private jet just because it sounds awesome. I love helicopters. We're definitely going up. I want to see some city lights. I would operate differently because in one example I gave, because of the authority I operate in, I would operate differently in my second example because of what I have access to. Listen to me, Christian. I want you to hear me say this. You have access to the fullness of God. As a follower of Christ Jesus, a son, a daughter of the Most High King, you and I walk in his authority and we walk with the availability of what he makes available to us. It is greater than us. It is bigger than us. And if I understand that this mind game, I'm going into it on who he is, not who I am in and of myself, I will speak more boldly, I will operate more confidently, and I will utilize more resources available to me. This is why David showed up to the battlefield and he said, I'm going to show you because I come to you in the name of the Lord Almighty. David understood who was with him. He understood whose authority he had, and he understood all the resources that were available to him because of who he was in his heavenly Father. Now, I want to digress in the story just a little bit. I actually want to go a few verses back because this is a absolutely remarkable story. It's something that I can't even imagine, quite frankly, this going on, because if you read the context of this story, if you follow along at all, and I would recommend, by the way, if you've never read it, open up your Bible and check it out. This boy David, a shepherd boy David, gets permission from the king to go fight one of the greatest warriors that Israel had ever seen, had ever been faced with. There's unbelievable things at stake. There is so much at stake here. And yet the king, Saul, gives David the permission to go fight on behalf of the entire army with all that was at risk with the outcome of this battle. But I want to take you just a few verses back to the conversation that led to the king's decision. I want to take you to verse 32 through 36. We're going to pick up this story. David is communicating to King Saul, and he says this, "Don't worry about this Philistine," David told Saul. "I'll go fight him." And Saul replied, "Don't be ridiculous. There's no way you can fight the Philistine and possibly win. You're only a boy, and he's been a man of war since his youth." But David persisted. And I want you to watch what David does. He persisted. "I've been taking care of my father's sheep and goats," he said. "When a lion or a bear comes to steal a lamb from the flock, I go after it with a club. And I rescue the lamb from its mouth. If the animal turns on me, I catch it by the jaw and I club it to death." Verse 36, "I have done this to both lions and bears. I'll do it to this pagan Philistine too." Here's what I want to communicate to you today. That David's confidence to fight a giant didn't start with a giant. It started with some sheep and some goats. David understood that he had a responsibility as a shepherd to protect and to guard. Then he talks about when a lion or a bear would come and take one of those small sheep or small goats away, that he would actually go and pursue it. He would run it down and he would rescue the small lamb and bring it back to the flock. And if that lion or bear would turn on him, astounds me that David said, "I would grab it by the jaw and I would club it to death. Here's what I want you to hear me say, that David had the confidence, David had the courage to face a giant because David was moving with momentum. Now, in these past couple of weeks, we've been intentionally doing some things as a church family. We've been joining each day in a daily devotion where we are reading the same encouragement. We are looking at declarations that we are speaking out loud. We are looking at verses that support the truth of those statements. We've been getting them in our hearts. Some of you took my challenge last Sunday and you wrote a personal declaration about who you are in God and who you're becoming because of Him. And here's what's been happening. We've been building our momentum. It's starting to gain. And so some of you have been in a mind game that you've been losing, but something is beginning to change. Momentum is on your side. One of my great heroes in the faith, John Maxwell, he's an author, he was a pastor, he's an amazing leader, he's a world voice on leadership. He talks about momentum like this. He calls it the big mo. And he says, when the big mo is on your side, you gotta keep it moving. You can't stop big mo. Some of you have created in the last couple of weeks some momentum. Some things are starting to happen. You've actually been making some progress. And what I want to say to you is keep going, because you may feel like there are giants in your future, but I'm just encouraging you right now, just face the bear, just face the lion. It's going to build the confidence in you. It's going to bring something up in you. For some of you, it's just time to start. You've got to get going. Some of you, momentum is already moving. Others of you, you need to get momentum going. I want to speak to you something that I say. This is something that I utilize often, and I especially utilize it when I am going into something that I really don't want to do. Let me give you an example. Not too long ago, in the very first probably week and a half, 2 weeks of quarantine, my wife and I decided that we were going to paint our bedroom. I have to tell you that I think painting is perhaps some of the worst torture that a human can go through in all the world. It's just barely above running. It's a terrible exercise. I don't like to do it. I know some of you love painting. I know some of you love running. This is not me. And so here's me going into this moment where I know we're going to paint the room. I really don't want to paint the room, but I really want the result of the painted room. And so I have this thing that I'll say it all the time, especially when I'm heading into something I don't want to do. I'll say this: if I don't start, I'll never finish. If I don't get started, I'll never finish. In other words, the sooner I get this thing going, the sooner that I get to the finish line. So maybe it's the broccoli on your plate because you're 8 years old and you're not allowed to have dessert until you eat it. But the sooner you take a bite of that broccoli, the sooner you can get to your dessert. I hope this is making sense. But I want to say to some of you that it's just time to get going. If you don't start, you'll never finish. And it's time for you to get some momentum going. It's time for you to get, it's in your hands now. I've understood there's a battle in my head. I understand that I'm putting God's word, it's in my heart. It's time for you now to get it into your hands. I've got to get in motion. I've got to get in action. If I never start, I'll never finish. There are some of you that you are trying to hold things in your hand that are not yours to hold. There are some of you that you're clinging to something that is not yours. In other words, you're trying to control something that is beyond your control. For you, it might be time to just let go. I want to give you another quote from another one of my heroes in the faith. He often says this: it is not always in our power to control, but it is always in our power to surrender. And for some of you, it's just time. You got to let some things go because it's in your hands and you're trying to control something that you simply cannot control. What can I control? I can control my speech. I can control my actions. I can begin to control the momentum of my life because I'm going to align myself with the truth of what God's word says about me. My thoughts determine my actions. I'm going to move with the momentum and the authority of my Heavenly Father. I can control this. It's time to get it in your hands. So let me get practical and let me help you in how you can gain some momentum in this mind game that you may be playing. Some years ago, I was at a church conference. It was for pastors, and we were inundated for 3 days with some of the most amazing resources, amazing teaching. I was writing notes like a madman, just trying to get all this content into my heart so that I could go back to our church and start doing some things that would improve everything. To be quite honest with you, it was almost overwhelming. There was so much good that I was almost completely overwhelmed by all the content. One of the leaders of the conference, he came at the very end and he began to describe something. This is what he said. He said, listen, a lot of you have had all kinds of things brought to you, just like I was describing. You have all this stuff going on. You're wondering, man, when I go back home, when I go back to my church, where do I even begin? What do I even do? And so he said, I want you to ask yourself this question. Here was the question he said. What one thing, not all the things, just one. What one thing, if I went back to my church and changed, would make the biggest difference? What one thing, if it changed, would make the biggest difference? I wanted to ask you that question this morning. What one thing in your life, if it began to change, would make the biggest difference? But I actually want to change the question for you just a little bit. There are probably some of you that know how to answer that. You already know, like right now, it's risen up on the inside of you that, yeah, if I fix that, things would get better. There are others of you, I think that you're like, I don't know, Pastor Josh. I just know stuff needs to change. Things need to change. I'm not sure what one thing, I just need something to change. Here's my new question that I want to ask you this morning. What one thing, let me start over. What is one thing you can focus on that will make a difference in your life? Listen to me, a difference. Something that would be different. Maybe you see a giant, but you first need to face a bear. Let's don't tackle the big thing. Let's focus and tackle a thing. Early this year, I read a book and he talked about habits and building healthy habits and gaining momentum in your life. And he actually talked about tackling small, simple things early. He would say, hey, if you have goals for the day, just do something as simple as saying, hey, I'm gonna wake up in the morning, I'm gonna make my bed. Why? Because I've achieved something. Something is done, something looks better, and you begin to build on top of that. You feel more accomplished, and as you go, you will grow into bigger things. Small steps become giant leaps. They simply do. So your question number one, to make it practical, what is one thing you can focus on that will make a difference in your life? I don't want you to be overwhelmed. I just want you to be strategic. Let's just pick something that if I am going to speak to this, I'm going to fight this battle, I'm going to win this one. And then when I conquer that one, I'll move and I'll move and I'll move to the next, to the next, to the next. The second question that I want you to ask is this: what is a small habit you can create that will become a bigger habit later? What is one small habit that you can create that will become a bigger habit later? All right, let me contextualize it like this. Maybe you have a goal. It's a weight loss goal. Let's just say that it's that. And maybe Satan has been speaking lies into your spirit about who you are as a person because of your physical appearance. So he's actually getting you to believe false things about you on the inside based on how you feel about you on the outside. And here's what you know. You know that you probably should eat differently, that you should start exercising, that you should be more careful, whatever it is. You could probably build a list of things that you need to do. But maybe you just break it down into smaller bite-sized pieces. Let me give you a very simple example. Maybe you know you're more of a morning person than an afternoon person. And for you to exercise, the best time to get it done would be first thing in the morning because you're more of an AM than a PM type person. And so maybe you don't start by saying, I'm gonna wake up early, I'm gonna join a gym, I'm gonna work out 5 days a week. You might be trying to tackle a giant when I'm just encouraging you to face a bear. So maybe you just decide that, hey, on Monday morning, I'm gonna wake up 30 minutes earlier and I'm gonna do that for 5 days. And that's all I'm gonna do. I'm gonna tackle a bear and I'm gonna beat it. I'm gonna prove that I can just wake up early enough to work out. And then maybe after a week's worth of success, the very next week you say, all right, I'm gonna wake up now on time. I'm going to take a walk around the block. I'm gonna start there. And all of a sudden what happens is we start to build momentum. On one small decision becomes another good decision that becomes another good decision, and they begin to stack on top of each other. And then all of a sudden you have the confidence to face your giant Why? Because you've just made some decisions. You've begun to stack some things on top of one another that's creating momentum in your life, that's going to build your confidence, that's going to build your belief in who you are in Christ Jesus. What I want for you is this. I want you to have the confidence to face your giant and say, I come at you in the name of the Lord Almighty. We're going to learn from King David today, and we're going to take this momentum and this confidence that he had that would propel him to become the king of God's people, that would propel him to become one of the greatest warriors in biblical history. It started as a small shepherd boy with some sheep, some goats, and some small victories. Church, I couldn't emphasize enough how much I believe in you and how much I know is inside of you because of the Christ that you serve and follow. Jesus Christ has paid a price that's giving you access to all God has. You are more than a conqueror because of Christ Jesus. Greater is he, being Jesus, who is in you than he that is in the world. You can do all things through Christ who gives you the strength. You are an elite warrior that can knock down giants. Why? Because God is in you. Why? Because you come at your enemy in the authority of God Almighty. You have access to all that he has given you. I want to pray for you, and then I want to just talk to some people who perhaps are not following Christ Jesus yet. Father, I pray for every person in our church who's in a mind game. Maybe it's because of this COVID-19 season. Maybe it's because of a quarantine demand that's been put on us. Maybe it's a battle they've been facing for years. Father, whatever it is, I want to lift them up to you. I want to lift up every single person, Lord God, listening to my voice that tuned into this message, whether they are a part of our church family or not. God, I want to lift them up to you and ask you to give them the strength and the courage to get it from their heads to their hearts to their hands. I pray, Father, that they would fight their enemies with the power that you give. I pray that every lie that Satan is speaking into their lives, they would find truth from your scripture and begin to replace those negative thoughts with spiritual truths. I pray in Jesus' name, Lord God, that they would begin to walk in more and more confidence because they're just strategically moving from battle to battle to battle. It will start small, but it can end big. I pray, Father, in Jesus' name, that they would gain confidence and momentum, not because of the way they see themselves, but because of the way they see themselves in you. Strengthen us, I pray, Father, in Jesus' name, to knock down our giants. Now, maybe you're watching this morning and you say, I've never made a decision to follow Jesus. All morning you've been talking to Christ followers and knowing who we are. I want to invite you to make that decision right now. Every Sunday we do this. In fact, I'm never going to preach and not do this because I just believe that there are some of you that maybe you've been kicking the tires about Christianity, or maybe you're just not sure about faith in God. But perhaps today the Holy Spirit has moved in your heart and you say, yeah, I want to do that. I want to move in the authority of my Heavenly Father. If that's you, I want to invite you to say a simple prayer with me. The Bible says that if we believe in our hearts and we confess with our mouths that Jesus is Lord, we will be saved. And so what I want to encourage you to do is actually repeat a prayer after me. This is going to be your moment. This is going to be your moment where you step out of darkness and into light. This is going to be where you leave death and you walk in life. This is where you become a child of the Most High King and you have his authority and access to all that he has. Now, every week, I ask our church family to repeat this prayer after me, even if you've said it before, in the hopes that somebody may be in the room with you who's never said it before. I want them to be able to say it with the confidence of all their heart. And so I want to say this prayer, and if you're saying it for the first time, I want you to boldly declare it with me. In fact, I'm going to ask everybody in studio, I want you to just repeat it with me out loud, if you would. I want you to say, Dear Jesus, I give you my life, all of it. Come into my heart. Forgive me of my sin. Wash me, cleanse me, make me new. All that I am is yours. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, amen. Thank you guys for praying. Thank you guys for saying it confidently and perhaps for the first time. Congratulations, welcome to the family. Listen, I love you guys, as I mentioned before, and miss you dearly. I want you to stick around for just another minute as our host comes to close us out. Thanks for being with us.
And what such a great message that was. Hey, thank you so much, Pastor Josh. And guys, if you made a decision for Christ, will you please let us know? What we did is that we created a digital connection card for you, and it's in the link below. And if you could just fill that out, what we'll do is follow up with you and give you information on your next steps. And why do we do it? Because we care about you.
We would love to be able to join with you in prayer. If you have things that you would like to have our prayer team and our pastors pray with you about, please visit churchontherock.net and click prayer. Also, if you'd like to join Church on the Rock, we will be having step one of All Access today at 12:30. Just visit churchontherock.net to register for our Zoom call.
And guys, you are such a generous church. In fact, we call this portion where you get to worship your God with your giving. And I do want to say this. If you're a guest or a visitor, hey, please feel no pressure to give. In fact, if you have a home church and you're just visiting our church, will you do us a favor and give to your church? Because the members of Church on the Rock are so generous. They really do a great job of supporting the ministry that we do here. So thank you guys for your generosity. In fact, what we want to do is actually show you a video of just the impact that you're making in our city. Check this out.
Hey guys, Pastor Rogers Callens here and Jody Saunders.
Hey!
And we're at Dining with Dignity. Jody, can you tell us what Dining with Dignity is and what's happening tonight?
So Dining with Dignity is a program that is under Home Again St. John's County, and we feed the homeless and needy of our community. There's a group that takes one night a week, so there's somebody that comes out and feeds everybody at least one night every night of the month.
Again, church, you guys are awesome. Thank you so much for your generosity. And by the way, there are actually three ways that you can give at Church on the Rock. The first is on our website at churchontherock.net/giving. The second is by texting COTR to 77977. And then the last is that you can mail your tithes and offerings to our church location at 2995 Barilla Avenue, St. Augustine, Florida. Again, you guys are awesome. Thank y'all so much. Have a good day.